Cascade Hoops Talk, Billy D. Join us on Twitter, Cascade Hoop Talk. Hey, today we're thrilled to have Daryl Bowie, Ottawa University. Daryl played 2 years at Ottawa. He scored 700 points and almost 600 of those coming this season. Named first team KCAC as well as the KCAC Player of the Year. Daryl is also second team All-American. Welcome, Daryl. You should be very proud of what you accomplished this season.
It's a blessing to be here. Thank you for having me.
So, Daryl, I want to ask you, you grew up in, you went to high school in Rome, Georgia. You played at Henry County High School. And probably what a lot of people don't know about you is you were also a heck of a cross-country runner. You were MVP in the cross-country team. You played in the Metro Atlanta All-Star Basketball Game, and you played travel ball for those Georgia Ballers under head coach Gerald Alford. Just talk about your high school years.
I went to a high school like right outside of Atlanta, Georgia, my first 3 years, Heritage High School. Didn't play much there. That's where I ran cross-country at, and I was doing cross-country to get in shape for basketball. I just happened to be good at it. Ended up qualifying for state and cross-country, but I knew I wanted to pursue a basketball career and wanted to play that collegiately. So I ended up transferring to Henry County. My coach there, Coach Rossa, ended up bringing me in, and he showed me a lot of love, man. And I ended up having a good season there.
So do you actually enjoy running?
Not now, I don't. Not now. But at the time, it was pretty fun. It was different.
But what made you good at it? Were you quick or just had a lot of stamina? Or
I think I had a lot of stamina at the time. Like I said, I was just doing it to get ready for basketball season, make sure I was in shape. But I ended up being better than I thought I'd be.
So talk about that senior year at Henry County. Did you guys have a good team?
Man, we were like 500. We were pretty good, though. We had the pieces. We just couldn't put it together. But it's crazy. From like high school to even college, I didn't really have a breakout year till my last year, my senior year of high school and my senior year of college. And it's crazy. I came off the bench both years. I came off the bench my senior year in high school. But, I mean, I played most of the time and had a big impact, I feel like.
Out of high school, you went to Sneed Community. You didn't get to play very much there. The team, it looked like you had kind of a rough season. You know, just talk about that year at Sneed.
I honestly, like my full college career, I didn't have the best college career. I'm not going to act like I did. My freshman year, I did go to Sneed State. I believe we won like 5 games that year. But I was a bench player, like. And I played my role hoping that I would end up getting a chance to play my sophomore season, but my coach ended up leaving. Yeah, I think we won like 5 games. I probably played in a cumulative of the whole season, maybe 8 minutes, 9 minutes. So, I mean, my freshman year was rough. My sophomore year was rough, too. I ended up transferring to Stillman College. Then basically wasn't even on the team there. I was basically a walk-on without even dressing up with the team.
You know, Daryl, let me correct one thing for you. You kind of interrupted yourself and said you didn't have a great career. I think that you're selling yourself short. And I personally think your story is one well worth telling. And it's an amazing story because everything just didn't come real quick and easy for you. And you kept pushing and you drove yourself to get better and better and better. And so, you know, those experiences at Sneed and then going to Stillman and not just basically being on the bench, you know, did that make you hungrier to, because you really wanted to play college basketball, right?
Yes, sir, I did. It definitely made me hungrier. I mean, it humbled me as well, because coming off my senior year in high school, I was feeling real good about myself. I was always humble, but my route was just different. I know once I was leaving Stillman, I knew I was going to try to transfer out of there. I already told the coach at the time, and that whole semester from January to May, I would get up. I stayed with my cousin. I would get up in the morning at 4 in the morning, and I would have class at 1. So I'd go to the gym from 4 in the morning to 12 p.m., and I'd be in the gym the whole time just getting up shots, practicing different stuff. And I did that consistently. I didn't miss a day from January to May, and I felt like it'd pay off eventually, and it just happened to be the year.
And you did that because you wanted to be a college basketball player.
Yes, sir. Not even knowing if I'd get the opportunity, knowing how my first 2 years went. just prayed a lot, and I just made sure I was doing my part by putting in the work.
So talk about the decision to go to Ottawa. How did that come about?
Coach told me that he would help me get to another school because he knew I was having a rough time with the schools before. And I think he was just sending out emails, and I ended up getting, like, I guess he said he sent out like 300 emails, and I had like six hit me back, and Ottawa ended up being one of them. And he told me that they liked my film, and I talked to Coach Siebenthal on the phone, and they took a chance on me. It was up from there. It was a blessing.
So in your junior year, you know, like you said, you had been to Snead, then Stillman. You really hadn't gotten your groove yet, found your game, whatever term you want to use. You played in 22 games as a junior. You were used sparingly. Mm-hmm. What did you learn about yourself as a basketball player? That Kansas Conference, playing at Ottawa, that's pretty competitive basketball. What did you learn about yourself?
Well, I learned that, personally, that I have to buy in more to the system. I mean, I feel like I was bought in at my first two schools, but like I said, they didn't work out. And I can say that my style of play was different when I first got to Kansas, because it's a different style of playing from down south, I feel like, from Georgia going to Kansas. And I was just playing differently. And my coach, Coach Siebenthal, he wanted me to play a certain way. And I just had to learn how to play his way with playing my game at the same time. And so I feel like over my junior year, that helped me develop, learning from him more and more, and him telling me and sitting me down and talking to me like, hey, I need you to do this. I need you to drive, get in the paint, kick it out to shooters. In the shot clock, Dennis, I want you to look to score first. If not, kick it. You know, I just had to adjust to how he wanted me to play, and I feel like I learned that around the middle part of my junior season.
So that's interesting, Daryl. What do you mean there was a difference between the basketball you played more down south and then what they wanted in Kansas?
I'm from Birmingham, Alabama. I feel like it's the same from Birmingham to Atlanta. It's more of a strictly up and down pace, not really looking too much for offense. I mean, you can drive and kick, but the first thing is to just score on the person in front of you.
Okay.
Honestly, I feel like in coming to Kansas, it's not, I wouldn't say systematic, because I love the way they play out there. I mean, if I had to pick, I'd probably pick playing ball in Kansas, because the way they play is getting everybody involved. You don't have one person just not touching the ball at all and just strictly defense. I mean, everybody's touching the ball. It's just on you what you want to do with it. But, yeah, it was just different in terms of getting down, sharing the ball from the jump instead of just coming down and not trying to score immediately. So that was a big adjustment for me to make. And, but I love it. I love the way they play out there. And it changed my game. It helped me with that one.
That first year at Ottawa, that was your first year playing NAI ball. You know, tell us about your initiation into the NAI, you know, what was your opinion of it coming in, and did you learn anything about it?
I learned that level doesn't matter, that's for sure. There was a lot of D1 transfers coming in. I'm not sure how many it was that year, but I know this past season it was a few D1 transfers in our conference. I mean, you had some that was playing, you had some that weren't playing at all. So, I mean, level doesn't really matter, but yeah, it was very competitive. I mean, my first year when I was redshirting, I think the first scrimmage, Ottawa, we played Emporia State, and they beat them. So, I mean, that had a big toll on me. Like, it doesn't matter who it is, as long as you play as a team and do what you got to do to win.
Daryl, you talked about, you know, how you continued to grow as a basketball player, how you pushed yourself. I said in your junior year, you know, your cumulative minutes weren't a lot, but you were playing more and more, and you were scoring more and more as the season went on. And I thought, and I'd like your opinion, I thought in February there were a couple of games, both of them overtime games. First, you guys beat McPherson in overtime, and you scored half of Ottawa's points in overtime. And then 4 days later, Oklahoma Wesleyan was really good that year. You scored 25 points. You played over 25 minutes. Did you feel after those two games, those two overtime games that you contributed so much to, that you had finally broken out and were the basketball player you always knew you could be?
Yes, sir. Honestly, it was a game kind of right before McPherson. We played at Bethel, and like this was still around the time I wasn't playing. I didn't play the whole game. I ended up playing the last 5 minutes of the game. It was a close game. I think we were down 7, and I guess coach just took a chance on me. I mean, because it had been the whole season. I mean, we were winning, but not winning how we were supposed to. And Bethel, they was a pretty good team, and it was just a close game. And coach put me in, and we were down 7 with like 4 minutes left, and we ended up winning by 7. And I played those last 4 minutes, and I had a pretty decent game. I was feeling good about myself, and that going into that McPherson game, I had a lot of confidence, man. Coach was putting more confidence in me, like setting me up to do more plays on ISO and last-second shot clock stuff. And so my game, it was just easy to come to me because I'm more of a, like I said, up-paced basketball player. I like getting up and down the court. That's my type of game. So that McPherson game, that was a good game for me, but that Oklahoma-Westman game, it sealed it. I feel like that's where my career was making a change, and I was finally being able to break through as a basketball player, man. I felt real good about going into my senior season.
You talked about, you're quick, you're fast, you have a lot of endurance, you can get up and down the court, but you're relatively slight for a college basketball player. Did that ever cause you a problem?
Definitely. I feel like that's the reason why I didn't play much at my junior college or my next school is because of my size. I remember my junior college when I first went up there to work out. I mean, I was doing everything the other guards couldn't do, and my coach still told me, well, this certain guy's my starting point guard because he's 6'2". He has a nice frame, and I'm like, I'm in my head, his frame. Yep. He has a good frame, but what is he doing on the court? What's his production level like that I'm not doing? And, I mean, it wasn't to slight him. Like, it was nothing against the player because I've never had a problem with a player. I've never hated on a player. Like, I waited my turn. But, like, I was thinking, like what is he doing that I'm not doing?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm boxing out. I'm rebounding. I'm pushing the pace. I'm making sure my team is involved. So, I mean, yes, it was definitely a slight on me, but I feel like that's why those extra hours in the gym pay off, because then I start hitting tough shots that other players weren't able to make on a consistent basis. So I had to do something to set me apart.
Yeah, do you think maybe your first couple of years you were a little bit of a victim of the, I'll call it the eye test, where they look at you and say, well, he can't be our starting point guard. He's just not big enough.
Yeah, I feel like that's a lot of problem with college basketball. I'm not saying every small guard should get a chance, but I mean, I feel like there's a difference between guards who actually take the game serious, who's in the gym. I mean, you can tell, any college coach can tell who's really putting in the work and who's really not. But I feel like, man, it's so many guards that has the potential to be something great. And that's why I'm glad you're giving me this opportunity, because I want to get it out there. Like, little guards can play too, man. It doesn't matter how big you are, what size you are, because, I mean, this whole season, everybody that was guarding me was 6'3", 6'4", plus. I mean, it was games where they have a guard 6'6", on me, and it still wouldn't help them. So, I mean, it doesn't matter, like, the size of the player. And that's on the offensive or defensive end.
Daryl, coming into this season, Tasmania Indiana Jones, probably the greatest name in college basketball, and Isaiah Palmer, they had graduated. You know, how did you feel about that? You got to admit, Daryl, that's a great name.
That is. My God, man.
How did you feel about this season's team, you know, coming into your senior season? With those two guys were really good.
They were. Yeah, my junior year, it was more of a finding those guys, getting them the ball and making sure they was able to be in position to score. And so I knew once they were leaving, I took it upon myself last summer. I was practicing so many different shots, and I would do it, like, the repetition numbers were crazy. I 150 step backs to the right side, then 150 step backs to the left side, just practicing all different type of shots, because I knew, after knowing the players we were bringing in too, I just knew and felt like I was going to have to be a more of an offensive threat. And, yeah, man, it's just, I knew that I was going to get my real opportunity to show what I would be able to do. And I was blessed, man.
Could you sense that this was going to be your opportunity this year with those guys graduating?
Yeah. Yes, sir. When we beat the number one team in the nation, Oklahoma-Westman, I had 25 points. After that game, I knew Like, if this is the number one team in the nation, I'm like, I know that I got a lot more to show. And I could sense Coach Siebenthal, he looking more towards me to be more of a leader, and he's allowing me to show my game. So I want to thank Coach Siebenthal for the opportunity.
So you did, you talked about it. You guys started out really hot this year. You went on a long winning streak. Mm-hmm. You guys really got tested in November. Oklahoma Wesleyan. Mm-hmm. Why does it always seem like it's always Oklahoma Wesleyan?
They are good, man. Yeah, the program is great.
They came to town. You had a great game. You scored 30 points that game. You were up by 10 with a minute to go. Mm-hmm. Brooks Haddock just went unconscious. I don't know if you remember that.
Definitely.
But
I remember.
talk about the last 50 seconds of that game.
It got scary, man. Bruce, he's a great player. And the thing about him is he's young. He's a sophomore.
Yeah.
And he's an All-American already. I got a lot of respect for him, man. The type of shots he take too, that's my thing too. He's like it's no slight on him. He's around like 6'2", 6'3", but I mean he shoots fadeaways consistently. And now that's the difference, man. So now he's gonna be really good. I've been telling my boy Jaquan, it could be his league next year, but Brooks Haddock, he's definitely looking good to be controlling the league next year, man. He's a great player.
Yeah, he's a really good player. And you and I talked about before we started, he did basically the same thing to Spring Arbor. It looked like Spring Arbor was
amazing performance.
Yep. They were in control of that game, and then he just took over.
Yeah.
So
quick.
And then when they took the three away from him, he really responded well, and he started, taking the and challenged 16, 18 footers and still hitting those.
Yes. You can tell he practiced those shots, man, on a consistent basis. That's the thing. It's just all repetition, man. And I feel like he's got that aspect of the game down already. So he's going to be very successful for the next 2 years on the collegiate level.
You know, Darryl, I thought another key game for you guys this year was in January. You went to Kansas Wesleyan, and they really had you on the ropes. They were up by one with a minute to go. You scored 12 points in the final 7 minutes of that game. I don't know if you remember anything about that game, but you know you're known as a clutch player. Why do you think you perform so well toward the end of games?
I feel like I know that was to separate me at my size. I gotta be able to do something different. I just never back down from those moments. I love those moments. I think I remember that game going into halftime. I had 2 points. I remember specifically I had 2 points going into halftime, and I just knew I had to pick it up, because if I'm not picking it up offensively, I feel like my team looks to me to pick it up offensively, not even just in scoring. I mean, that could be me getting in the lane at least and making a play for somebody else. So as long as I'm aggressive on the offensive end, I always feel like we're going to be great regardless, and we're going to be fine. And I told them at halftime that I was going to pick it up. And so, I mean, it took me some time to get going, but my teammates trusted me, man, and I thank them for that. I remember they ended up finding me at the end of the game and hit a game winner. So, I mean, I never backed down from those moments, though.
Yeah, Darryl, that game was at Kansas Wesleyan, and there are some tough places to play in that conference. Where's the toughest place in that conference to play?
The toughest place to play in that conference, I got to say, Oklahoma Wesleyan, man. It's just something about that gym. I don't get it. It's something about that gym, though. It's hard to play there. They always have a packed house, especially when they're playing against Ottawa for some reason. I don't know if that's the new rivalry or what it is, but they always got a packed house, and the fans are loud into it. And I haven't gotten a rhythm for their goals, man. I never was able to get going on their goals. But that is definitely, I would say that's the toughest place to play for sure in the conference.
You know, for anybody who doesn't know, Darryl was Conference Player of the Year, second team All-American. And Darryl, you came off the bench all season. Just talk about why you guys did that. That's very unusual. It's probably the most interesting thing about your season.
I feel like that goes back into, like, piggybacking off my freshman and sophomore year. Really, my freshman year, like I started at the bottom. So, I mean, whatever coach wanted me to do this year, I was all for it. And he told me, like, we're going to bring you off the bench again. He felt like I was a huge spark off the bench. And, I mean, I told him, I said, that's perfectly fine with me. And even on my senior night, he offered for me to start on my senior night. And I told him, I'm like, coach, I honestly, I don't want to start. I want to do what it takes for us to win this game, and I don't want to mess up the rhythm we got. And that game was for us to clinch a conference against Kansas Wesleyan at home. So, I mean, that was just coach's modem, and he wanted us to do that, and I was all in for it.
So you guys ended up beating them pretty handily.
Definitely, and it was real cool, man. My boys, 1K, my brothers, they came out there and watched that game with me, and they walked out with me my senior night. But that was a very emotional and big game for me, too.
You know, what did that feel like to walk out there with your family and, you know that you were, mm-hmm. basically you were wrapping up your college career?
It was a surreal moment. I just felt like, I honestly can't tell you how I feel. I just remember my bro looking over at me and said, you did it. And I mean, he was saying too that you're not done, but at the time he was saying you did it. And that's what really hit me, because I feel like I did what I set out to do. I wrote my goals out, and I achieved all of them. Most of them I exceeded, so it was a blessing for me, man. I'll never forget that moment.
You came a long way from that young man who couldn't hardly get on the court at Snead Community.
Definitely.
Kansas Conference Definitely. Player of the Year in the NAI, second team All-American. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you should be very proud of what you accomplished.
I appreciate that, man.
You know, you get into the conference tournament, you start out, you thump York, beat them pretty good. You play McPherson. It's not a runaway, but you beat them. And then you got to play Oklahoma Wesleyan again for the championship. So how did you guys feel, you know, going into that game? I'm sure you had been ranked like in the top 10 most of the season, and you dominated the conference. You won the conference. I mean, how badly did you guys want to beat Oklahoma Wesleyan and show that this year was your year in the KCAC?
Yeah, well, that was a tiebreaker for us, man. So we were so excited for that game, and we was pumped up the whole day. I mean, we were barely sitting down on the bus. Like, we were so anxious to play, man. And I mean, no discredit to them. They had an amazing game. They got out running on us. I mean, we was in it at the beginning. We even had a big comeback at halftime. And we got back in the game, but, I mean, they were just hitting clutch shots. I didn't have a good game at all that game. They were throwing different defensive schemes at me, and I wasn't ready for them, and they just had a better game plan that game.
So after that game, what was the mood of the team, and then how did that change the way you prepared for Sioux Falls?
A lot of us, we was hurt. I thought the whole team was actually weak. Because we knew that we wanted that game so bad, man, and we had been on a winning streak. And, it hurt. I feel like that refueled us, and that made us get our hunger back, getting ready for the national tournament and going in there and just having something to prove, because we feel like we were the number 5 team in the country. So losing that game, it was definitely it was unacceptable to us. And I feel like we had great practices going into the national tournament.
So then you were headed out to Sioux Falls. You found out you're going to play Concordia. What did you know about Concordia? What worried you about them? How did you think you matched up?
I didn't know anything about them. My coach, he said that they were a pretty good team. I mean, obviously, they're in the NAIA National Tournament, so they were a pretty good team. We watched film on them before we left, and even once we got to the hotel in Sioux Falls, I mean, they're a team full of shooters, man. So our biggest thing was just making sure we close out to every shooter. We wasn't in help too much. It's really, you just got to guard your guy. And so that was our biggest game plan on them. We wasn't too much worried about, like, us getting taken off the dribble. So our biggest thing was running them all off the line, because all of them could shoot from the 1 to the 5.
And so you ended up, they came in, they played a really good game. They had you down by 5 at halftime. What'd you guys talk about at halftime?
It's our last 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And for the seniors, this could be the last time we ever step on the court together. So I feel like that halftime speech Coach Steve gave us, it was big. He was just saying, I mean, we're in a great position. We've been down 15, 16 at halftime and came back and won. So, I mean, 5-7 point difference, that's nothing to us. And, I mean, we felt the same way. So our second half, our biggest thing was defense and coming out with a lot more intensity on the defensive end. And then on the offensive end, I felt like not just me, but a couple of us were settling. I know me personally, I was settling too much. I wasn't putting enough pressure on them. On the offensive end, I wasn't going to the goal like I usually do, and I just felt like second half I had to be more aggressive, most definitely, for us to get the win.
And in that second half, you came out and you battled. I think about 9 minutes to go, you were down by 12. But then you and Jaquan Daniels, you combined for 24 points in that final 9 minutes. But, Daryl, I thought the difference was you guys seemed to flick a switch on defense in that last, I'm going to say, 7 minutes.
Yeah.
I thought that turned the game around. You guys got a lot of turnovers. Yeah. You really, you know, you were quicker. You're a little more athletic.
Now, every timeout we had, our coach was just like, defense, defense, defense. He wasn't too much worried about the offensive end because, I mean, that's how it's been all year for us as a team. Like, we share the ball, we move the ball around, and whoever got the best shot, they take it. So on the offensive end, he knew we were going to be fine. So he wasn't saying nothing about offense. Our biggest thing was defense, getting stops. We call them kills when you get three stops in a row. So our biggest thing was just getting kills, and I think we ended up having like 4 or 5 kills where we had we got a lot of defensive stops, and that was our biggest thing. And making them uncomfortable. They were too comfortable in the first half. They were dribbling around. And they were making whatever plays they wanted to make. And that was a slight on us. And we just knew we had to turn it up on the defensive end to win the game. We did that. So.
Yeah, and you battled back. You were down by 20 seconds to go. Man, talk about that shot heard around the world. Ryan Haskins in the corner for 3. Man, talk about that.
Yeah, that was huge, man. I think I'm not sure how he shot that game. I don't think he hit too many threes before that. But Ryan, he comes through, man. He came through all season for us. He always hit the 3 that we needed. And, I mean, that play was for him. And he came through, man. That's my boy. That's clearly the biggest shot of the year.
Yeah, that was the biggest shot of that tournament. Of course, the tournament got cut short. You guys won the final NAI Division II basketball game played. You couldn't finish the tournament. Nobody can take that away from you. So talk about the moment that you heard there was no more basketball, Daryl.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it. I mean, I knew all the coronavirus stuff was going on, and I thought everybody, I thought the whole NAI was taking the right precautions and stuff. I thought that never crossed my mind that they were going to cancel the tournament. But, I mean, as soon as we won and we went in the locker room, Coach Eve came back in the locker room. He had went out, and he came back in. We were still celebrating, and he was crying, and just like, guys, it's over. And I asked him in front of everybody, like, are you serious? Because I couldn't believe it, man. But we didn't know it was going to end like that right after a win. So, I mean, that one definitely hurt. But, man, it was a great season, so we couldn't complain. And we ended on a win.
Yeah.
And you would have felt like we would have lost. So.
And you were able to play and get into the final 16. A lot of teams there didn't even get that opportunity. So
yeah, I heard a lot of teams didn't even play, man. So that's a bad deal, man. I feel like it would have hurt worse to not even play. I feel for those teams. It was a great, can't say atmosphere because there weren't too many fans out there. But, I mean, it was just a great venue, great place to play. I had fun out there, man.
Hey, Daryl, what has it meant to you to be an Ottawa Brave, to be part of that great basketball program there?
A blessing. Because people always ask me, like, why you came off the bench, and did you ever ask your coach? And I always tell them, like, that coming off the bench was never a problem for me. Like, I was just so thankful for the opportunity because obviously he could have did like the other coaches did and not even gave me one. So him just allowing me to be able to play the game and help the team win to the best of my ability was a blessing for me, man. My brothers, man, my teammates, I don't even call them teammates, I call them my brothers. Mm-hmm. They supported me my whole time there. And I felt like they were more welcoming to me my senior year because they saw where I came from and how I handled myself through the adversity and not being able to play. And I mean, sitting the bench at my beginning times at Ottawa, being eligible to play. So, They were all for me, man, scoring the ball and just leading the team, and I can't thank them enough for that.
A guy who runs a great program, Coach Siebenthal. Talk about him for a moment.
Coach Steve, that's my guy, man. He's been a blessing since I met him. He's always been there for me. He always asks me if I need anything. He always checks in on me, making sure my family's straight. He's a great guy, man. Some people, I mean, he gets bashed. I mean, a lot of coaches get bashed for the things they do. Like I said, like bringing me off the bench, but that's not the importance, man. The importance is that he's making each one of us better human beings and better basketball players. And, I mean, he's just a great guy. He always stressed the importance of me getting my degree. And I graduated this summer, actually. I mean, I can't thank Coach Siebel enough. He's been a great mentor, great coach, a great guy to me. And, I mean, that's my coach for life. Me and Coach C, I go to war with him again. I told him that.
So, Daryl, tell us what you majored in and what your plans are after Ottawa.
I majored in sports studies. My plans right now, I've signed with an agent. I signed with Full Life Sports Management. Shout out to them. And Sean Couch and David Brill, I thank them for giving me the opportunity. I'll be playing professional basketball overseas. And I plan on having a pretty long career. And then once I'm done playing, I plan on being a college coach and giving back to the kids, hopefully in my community, man. And I plan on starting a foundation pretty soon while I'm overseas. So my thing now is just helping the kids out back where I'm from and just showing them that there is a way and that they can do whatever they want to do.
Daryl, I think your story is amazing. I think it should be a must listen for every high school player out there who thinks they want to play college basketball. Gives them an idea of what it takes to be a college basketball player. You don't just roll the ball out there and become one. You set a great example with your hard work. And Daryl, I really appreciate you being on the show, and I'm glad I got a chance to meet you and have you tell your story.
Man, thank you so much. I appreciate it. It's a blessing. God bless you. Thank you.